As before, I regard a solution u of tx of this nonlinear equation as a curve in a suitable functional Hilbert space. And accordingly, I write my equation as an ordinary differential equation in this space. So du over dt plus linear part of equation, something like Laplacian, plus nonlinearity. Plus nonlinearity f of u of t. F of u of t. And this equals to the random force, eta omega of t. Eta omega of t, and usually I have initial condition. When t equals to zero, this equals to zero. Crucial for me property is that this random force is bounded. Random force is bounded, so eta omega of t, eta omega of t, this is functional norm. It is bounded by some constant for every omega. I need some properties from this random force. One of them, like this. So, well, I decompose. In the space H, I take eigenbasis formed by eigenfunctions of the linear part of the equation, and I decompose my force in this basis. Then, this is decomposition on this basis in the space H. Now comes Fourier coefficient number J. It has the form Bj times eta j omega of t. This is usual game, and summation goes from 1 to m. And either m is either infinity, this is a relatively easy case, or m is small number, something like 2, 3, 4. This is where we really have to use optimal control, as I will explain today. Right, so these are eta j's are independent, identically distributed random processes. Another notation, so I denote by jr time segment of length 1 from r minus 1 to r, where r is any integer non-negative number. And I denote by eta with upper index r, upper index, the restriction of my process on the segment number r, right? And my another assumption is that here, of course, r equals to 1, 2, 3, etc. And my another crucial assumption is that these processes also are independent, identically distributed. Well, fortunately, there is one class of examples for the processes which satisfy all assumptions which I need. These are random Haar series. And this can be written in the references which I gave. In the very unlikely case that at my last lecture I will have time, I can talk on this. Now, among these segments, I denote segment J1 as J. Shift in time, I regard every process eta r as a random process defined on the segment J. So with the argument from 0 to 1. Now, excuse me. Now, I denote by E the space L2, 0, 1, 0, 1, H. This is a space where forces sits when we consider what happens for t from 0 to 1, right? And I denote by HM subspace where the force lives. So this is a span of first n basis vectors, phi 1 dots phi m, right? And another important for me space is the space E, which is just L2 space from zero t to HM. You see, as I stressed before, it maybe sounds non-logical. So my forces are bounded, they belong to space L infinity, but I take by it as my main space L2 space. Two reasons for this. Because it is very good to have Hilbert space not basis. More important that if I would take space L infinity, I would arrive at a space which is not separable, and this is really bad. Now, we change from from continuous time to discrete time. To discrete time, for this end, we consider the map S, which is the map from H, scalar product with E, where forces sits, back to the space H. And this is the mapping which moves initial data eta and the random force from 0 to t to the value of my solution at time 1, right? Immediately, then just of course we see that in fact what we are talking about, if I examine values of my solution at time 0, 1, 2, etc., then in fact I'm talking about system S. And the system S is a system defined by this relation. Value of my solution at time r plus 1 equals to the map S, applied to value of my solution at time r, and with random force with the kick number r plus 1. And this holds true for r bigger or equal to 0. And of course, u of 0 equals to u 0. This is the initial condition. One more notation. So this is a system. I have to start the trajectories of the system when time r goes to infinity. I adopt the following notation: u r of u 0, where r equals to 0, 1, etc. So this is trajectory of the system S. And I have to study what happens with these trajectories when time goes to infinity. Okay. So last time we have seen, and this is next to tautology, the following remarkable property that if I consider the law of my solution at time equals to 1, this law can be calculated in the following way. I take the map S, and I consider push forward under the mapping S of the measure, which is the distribution of the, let me call initial data V for the moment, it will be a bit more elegant. Of the measure, which is direct product of the distribution of the initial data V times measure L, where the measure L, which is the distribution of what I have here. So the law of the kick number R is independent by R, and this is by definition the measure L. Since my kicks are bounded, then the support of measure L is bounded in the space H, but I assumed more. I assumed that the support of the measure L, which I denoted as compact K, this is a compact inside space H. This is rather innocent assumption. It holds true for quite a lot of various examples. And of course, same relation tells us that the value of my solution at time k plus 1, this is the mapping S applied to measure, which is the law of my solution at time k, direct product with the measure L. So what does it mean? It means that if I want to study evolution of the distribution of my solution, right? Because this is what I'm really interested in. This is behavior of the distribution of my solution at time k, with k goes to infinity. We clearly see from the formula M that this evolution depends not on the specific choice of this kicks, eta r, etc., but only on the law of the distribution of the kick. Also, we see that to calculate distribution of my solution at k plus 1, I have to know only distribution of solution at time k, not at time k minus 1, etc., right? This means that the process uk, where k big or equal to 0, it's a Markov process with discrete time or a Markov chain. It is useful and easy exercise. Take in any book any rigorous definition of Markov processes and to see that this process is Markov. It is easy, it is not a big deal. Yes, thank you, right. this is the space. This is the space where the kick. It is just E. It is just E without N. Спасибо, Andreas. Right. So now I started to impose restrictions. There are restrictions which are innocent. Okay. So first restriction is just regularity. Let me remind to my restrictions. Restriction B1. Restriction B1 or B1 prime, because it corresponds to a stronger set of assumptions which I impose. This restriction tells me that the map S maps H scalar product with E not just to the space H, but to some smoother space, which is densely and compactly embedded into the space H. And that this mapping is C2 smooth. This is, so to say, experimental fact. If for some quasi-linear parabolic equations, we know that this equation is well posed, and we can prove that there exists only one solution, then the corresponding map is smooth and usually analytic. So this is rather innocent assumption, C2 smooth, right? Assumption B2 was the assumption stability of zero. It has two parts. First, if I examine the norm of U of S eta for any eta from the support of measure, because I do not care about right hand sides which do not belong to the support of my measure, right? Then the norm of this guy is bounded gamma times norm U plus some constant beta, where gamma is smaller than one. So this is stability of zero, and again, this is rather generical. This is true for huge class of equations. B, that the norm, that if I switch off the force, the norm S of U zero is bounded by gamma norm U. So look, roughly, if I have a quasi-linear parabolic equation from mathematical physics, such that with zero right-hand side, this equation is well posed, then all my restrictions hold for solution for this equation. On the contrary, if I take good equations from mathematical physics, then often when I put in the right-hand side white noise, I cannot prove that this equation is well posed, right? So bounded noises, they are much more comfortable. It is more comfortable to work with them. Right, so then this is, okay, then the data is like this. Now with all these objects in hand, let us define number R star. Let us define number R star, which is the following number, which is beta divided by 1 minus gamma. It's a finite quantity, as you see, right? Now comes easy exercise. Is the exercise which is really easy. Not two lines, maybe four lines. Four lines. Exercise tell us the following. That the ball in the space H, of radius R star closed ball, right? This is my notation for closed ball, right? Is invariant for the system S. And that is to say that if I take U such that norm U is bounded by R star, if I take eta from this compact K which is support of my measure L, then the norm of S of U eta also is bounded by R star. This is called that ball of radius R star is just absorbing set for my system. This is always like this for quasi-linear parabolic equations. Now, let us go back to the property B1. Look, from the property B1, we see that if norm U is bounded by R star, if eta belongs to K, right? Then S of U eta is bounded in the space V. is bounded in the space V, right? The norm in the space V is bounded by some constant K, which is a constant dependent, which is some, which is constant, which depends on this support of the measure and this number R star, and this number R star, right? But now the last. Okay, this is exercise. So this is end of this is the end of the exercise. This is trivial consequence of B1, which is now B1 prime. Now let us consider define the set X, which is a subset in my main space H. This subset is the following. I take the ball BH in the space R star. I intersect it with the ball in the space V of radius k, with this k, right? And I take closure in the space H. Then obviously, since V is compactly embedded in the space H, then this is a compact subset of the space H. If you look at these two or three lines of definition, you will immediately see that also X is invariant for my system. X is invariant as invariant for the system S. So in reality, my system evolves on smoother and bounded part of the main phase space H. So life of parabolic equation with bounded force often happens on some compact part of the space H. Because of this, I can consider restriction on the system S on the compact X. If I study this system, then after this, it is rather easy exercise to derive literally the same consequence for the original system. It is practically the same, and in the references which I gave you, you can find how to do it. It is not really exciting. So therefore, what happens? From now on, I am going to talk only for system S restricted to this compact X. So I will take initial data U0, initial data V, or random variable valued in the space X, and then solution with probability 1 always stays in X. And now I want to understand what happens when time goes to infinity. I need some small piece of probability. This is small piece of probability. This is not probability. Small piece of measure theory. This is called Lipschitz dual distance. Distance in the space of measures on M, where M is any Polish space. So we will see now that space of measures in any Polish space. This is in fact a metric space. I can introduce in this metric space a number of different matrix distances, but the one which I will tell you now is very, very comfortable. So, first notation. For this Polish space M, Polish complete separable matrix space, I consider O of M, which is a ball made by all bounded continuous function in the space M, such that supremum norm of this function is bounded by 1, and the Lipschitz constant of this function also is bounded by 1, right? And now comes a definition for any two measures on this matrix space of M. I defined a Lipschitz dual distance between mu and nu in the following way. I take supremum. Supremum is taken for all functions from this set OM, right? And supremum of what? I integrate function f against measure mu. I subtract function f integrated against measure nu, right? We immediately see that since I can take instead of f minus f, I can put here modulus, it will change nothing. So I will not write modulus here, right? Also, we immediately see that since f is bounded by 1, then the distance, between any two measures changes between 0 and 2. 0 and 2. This is trivial part. Highly non-trivial part is given by the following remarkable result theorem. This is a theorem due to Leonid Kantarovich, who was remarkable Soviet mathematician and economist who started to write his really who started to work in the 30s and he died, I think, in the 70s. He was the first brilliant mathematician who get Nobel Prize in economics, not Nash, Kantarovich. So this is one of his results. Okay, look. Fact number one. With this distance, the space of measures P of M becomes a Polish space. Right? So complete separableness, not only distance. It's really perfect distance. So if you have any Cauchy sequence of measures, then the limit exists, and it is also measure. And it is space separable. What is remarkable that, what is second remarkable property, that this distance metrizes weak convergence of measures. That is to say, if a sequence of measures mu n weakly converges to some limit in measure mu, it happens if and only if Lipschitz dual distance between mu n and mu, Lipschitz dual, goes to zero. Right? This is extremely useful, because this is much better work not with weak convergence of measures, which is not at all so remarkable, but with this distance. Okay. Okay. So this is what we will work with. Now, as I said, I will talk about system restricted to the compact, so to system S restricted to compact X. Therefore, all the measures, all the distributions of my solution, they will be measures supported by the compact X. So I can regard them either as measures on the space X, on my space H, or as measures on the space X. But there is another useful exercise that for the distances, it makes no difference. Exercise is the following. So if measures mu nu are supported by this X, are supported by X, then the Lipschitz dual distance, which I measure in the space H, this is the same as Lipschitz dual distance if I use the distance in the hole in the space X. Hint is the Kirsch-Brown theorem. This is very beautiful result. Kirsch-Brown, I am not sure about the spelling, but Google will tell you. Or just what tells me Kirsch-Brown theorem? Let us take a space of finite or infinite dimension, either just Rn or just Hilbert space. Let us consider any subset at all, not necessarily closed, not necessarily compact, any subset at all. Assume that you have on this set, let me call it Y, so this is not right, that we have on this set Y a Lipschitz function. Then Kirsch-Brown tells us that we can extend it to the whole space with the same Lipschitz constant, right? It is deep result. It is not at all easy to prove this. But, and this rather easily implies what I told you, right? Okay, now we have all definitions, we have all the objects, and now the main result, you see, this, it's a good result, so statement is short, proof is long. So maybe statement is short also but also my assumptions, they're not at all that big. Look, so assume that assumptions which I have imposed holds. assume either weak assumptions from B1 to B4 to B4, right? Or strong assumption to B1 prime to B4 prime, right? Assume this. Then we have theorem. Let U0 prime be any two initial data in the space X. Then for any k, the following holds. Look, I consider the law of my solution with initial data U0. I consider the law of another solution with initial data of 0 prime. I consider these laws at time k. I measure Lipschitz dual distance between the two, right? And then this Lipschitz dual distance is bounded by C times kappa to degree k times distance between u minus u0 prime. Right? Okay, so this is precisely that the laws of any two solution with deterministic initial data, but we will soon see that it is not important, converges. Distance between them converges to zero. Okay, corollary one is simply trivial. Corollary one immediately follows from the definition of Lipschitz dual distance. For any functional f, which is bounded Lipschitz on the space X, right, the following happens. If I take f of uk of u0, if I take expected value minus expected value of f of uk of u0 prime, right, that then this distance is bounded by c kappa to degree k u0 minus u0 prime, right? So f of solution in physics usually is called observable value, right? So any two observable values with any two initial data, they converge to the same limit. Very easy exercise, really easy exercise. Easy exercise is that if f any C1 smooth functional on the space X, then also star holds with C, which depends on this functional. So I can take practically any reasonable functional. You see, it should not be bounded just because all functions are C1 smooth, right? Right. Is this clear, right? So this is finally mixing. So we discuss this mixing in many times, but this is finally mixing appeared on the blackboard. Yes. Yes, Albert. This is kappa. Thank you. This is kappa smaller than one. Thank you. Yes, please. Thank you. Yes. Kappa is smaller than one. Yes, thanks, of course. Thank you. There exists kappa, right. Yes, thank you. There in this setting, yes. Yes. This is not good. Okay, this is, yes. Yes, you're just absolutely right. Sorry. There exist C, which is positive constant. There exists kappa, which is between 0 and 1, such that for any initial data, this holds true. This again, so my first question to the talk of Jean-Pierre was that after this your theorem, what else can be done? He said that, okay, we know that the density exists, but we know nothing about this density. Right, so similar here. To get some information about this, I need one more corollary. Just to make us happy. Corollary two, and look. And there exists measure mu, which is a measure supported by the space X, yes, such that such that for any initial data v, which is a random variable, v in x a random variable, for any random variable initial data, the following happens. If I take a law of the solution UK with this random initial data V, right, then the distance to this measure mu, to the measure mu, Lipschitz dual, obeys the same estimate. It is bounded by C1, kappa to K, and here comes Lipschitz dual distance times Lipschitz dual distance between the law of this random variable V and the measure mu star. You see? So asymptotically, this is very clever estimate. So it is not at all obvious. Well, but it is not complicated either. Let me give you a scheme of the proof. I do not want to write it because it will take time and it will draw your attention from the main scene which I want to talk about. Step one is to use the Markov property So it will be safer to tell like this. So in fact, this is the main result. You can find the proof of the derivation of this stuff in my paper with Huilin, because unfortunately to write the proof, I need one more notion. I have no time to do this, right? But this is called mu star, is called stationary measure for my system, right? And to study properties of stationary measure of specific nonlinear equation, which comes from physics, this is a physical problem of prime importance, okay? Now, so then finally we have arrived at maybe the most interesting part of my lectures, namely I will show how to prove this stuff. How to prove this result and how the theory of optimal control enters to the realm of mixing. So what the two have in common. So section four, this is proof of the theorem under the stronger assumptions B1 prime B4 prime. When the proof will be presented at the end of the next lecture, I will tell you the correction, some additional efforts which should be made just to prove the theorem under weaker assumptions. Okay, so to prove this, we will use Döbling coupling, plus quadratic convergence, and plus properties of Markov processes, Markov techniques. Markov techniques. This was remarkable for me, that in this setting, the quadratic convergence is being used in the form which is very close to the form which is it is used when we are proving Kolmogorov theorem, which underlies underlies KM theory. But maybe this is one of the easiest usages of the KM technique. Okay, so now, what is the Döblin idea? And I just repeat that I strongly advise you to look in Wikipedia for the paper about Döblin. Okay, so look, what is our task? Our task is to prove relation two. Relation two is that the distance of the solution uk of u0 minus the law of the solution uk of u0 prime, right? That this distance, Lipschitz dual, converges to zero when k converges to infinity. Then when we prove this and when we analyze our construction, we will see that the rate of convergence is just s in the theorem. So this is what we really want to achieve. Now comes the Döblin method of two equations. Method of two equations. Okay, watch. This is something really clever. Look, our phase space for the system S restricted on X, of course, is a compact X. Now, instead, in the doubled phase space X times X, Consider the doubled dynamics. Look, dynamics is the following. Dynamics is U of K, V of K, where K is bigger or equal than zero. And now I will tell you the initial data, and now I will tell you how to calculate this vector for k equals to k plus 1 if you know this vector for k equals to q. Initial data, you can guess what they are. U of 0 equals to u0, v of 0 equals to v0 prime, equals to v0 prime. And now dynamics. Dynamics is probably, I will put them here because of crucial importance. So three. Relation three as U of K, V of K, is being obtained for the same guys for K equal to minus one by the following formula. I have to take S of U of K minus one, eta K. Eta K is not literally the same which I have in the system. Just wait for a moment. And this is new U, right? And new V is the following one. S of V of K minus one, eta prime K, right? And this is for K bigger or equal than one, of course, right? Because for K equal to zero, we know who they are. Now, who are these UK prime? This is the whole point. This is why Döblin was really great. So look, eta K prime, eta prime k or eta k prime, it will be the same, of course. This is a mapping, eta k prime, applied to the following argument. Applied to uk minus one, vk minus one, and omega, right? So that is to say that this is a mapping. So this eta prime k, this is a mapping. Which mapping? This is a mapping from the space x times x, because this guy sits in the probability space. But some time ago, I explained that it is very good. We can do this we can say that the kick number k sits an independent copy of the probability space. This is the safest way. Then I'm absolutely sure that this kicks number k, they are definitely independent from the kicks k minus 1, right? Because they know absolutely nothing about kick number k minus 1, right? Okay, which kind are? So this is a mapping from here to, of course, to e times e. You see? Look. So this dynamics is essentially the same dynamics as before, with the difference that I cook kick number k in some special way. There will be comments now. This is again another copy of the same dynamics, but again the kick number k is not literally the same one, but just another one. So what are restrictions on this map? Restrictions on this map are the following. Look, let us consider the law of the eta k. When I fix v, and this, look, if I fix any u and v, then eta k becomes a random variable, right? Because by definition, random variable is a measurable mapping defined on the probability space. So I fixed any u and v. I can examine law of this random variable. The law of this random variable must be L, right? This is how it must be. So you see, so new value of new value of eta k is obtained in the following way. I take the mapping S, I apply it to old position u k minus 1, and I put here kick distributed as it should be distributed, right? And similar, of course, this is the law of the second guy is the same. Eta prime k of uv, right? Right, and this is true for any u, for any v, for any k. What is the point here? The point here is the following. Look, that this kicks eta k prime, of course, they're independent from all what was in the past. But they're not at all independent from each other. They're strongly correlated. You see, here comes kick number k. Here sits kick number k distributed as it should be distributed. Here comes another kick number k distributed as it should be distributed. But these two guys, they're not at all independent. They're heavily dependent, and this is what Döblin. And yes, of course, I do not remember if I said, of course, this is a measurable map, right? Right. Now comes the following lemma, which is the whole point. Lemma, which is the whole point. First, and now look. Due to this, of course, this k-th copy of the probability space, I denote point here omega k. It is natural, right? This is the same k. Now watch. Pair u of k, v of k depends only on initial data, u0 prime and omega 1 up to k, right? So they do not depend on the future, but it's obvious. So simply look how I have constructed this. Two. And this is why it's really very good. The law of uk, of course, equals to the law of my solution of uk with the initial data u0. The law of v of k, of course, is the law of solution uk with another initial data. You see what I have done. And property number three as the dynamics three, which I have here, defines a Markov chain. That the dynamics three is a Markov chain in the space x time x. In which sense? In the sense that the distribution of pair uk UK VK depends only on the distribution UK minus one, VK minus one, not on the choice of this random variable, not. You see? Okay, right. Now you see this one is obvious. One is obvious. Two is almost obvious. Let me show you just for the first step. Let me show you just the first step. In general case, so proof of two. I will not use three, so I do not care about three. I care about two. Proof of two. Let k equals to one. Let me show you how this machine run. Then let us consider d of u. Let us consider d of u of u1. But this is s of u0 applied to kick eta 1. This is a constant. This is a random variable. Therefore, this is nothing but image under the mapping S of the map. This is delta measure sys in the point u0 times L. But this is precisely the same formula as the law of my solution, which is somewhere there on the formula M, right? If I to prove this for k not one but bigger than one, I have to repeat this calculation for the case when u0 is not constant but a random variable. It's a good exercise for you. Nothing happens, just use this. Nothing apart from this. So this property which I denoted by letter M, this is nothing else is being used. Okay. D u0 of u0. Now it is clear what the strategy of the proof should be, right? So from here I have absolutely trivial consequence that the distance between my solution UK u0 and UK of u0 prime L star, right? Of course it equals to the distance of the law of UK minus distance of the law of VK, right? Right. So now to prove this relation to that this distance quickly converges to zero, right? I will simply prove the same statement that this distance quickly converges to zero. How I will prove this? I will prove this by choosing the map psi in such a way that this will become more or less clear in one way or another. Now just let us try to push forward this program. This is what Döblin was doing this when he invented his method. Of course, he was applying this for finite dimensional system. For finite dimensional system, it is very easy to explain what does it mean, but I have explained too much of extra, so I have no time to repeat this. By the way, it is explained rather well in my book with Ramin Sharikyan. We have there in index Döblin, so just go to Döblin and you will find. Andrei, you have a question? Yes. UK, no, it is not. But still, right, and you will see that you'll just three lines. Simply, I do not have time for these three lines because to explain them really, it will take at least 5 minutes. No, this is precisely correct. It's precisely correct. You see, the point is that it should be clear, Andrei. It should be clear. It should be obvious for you. Obvious, non-obvious. In fact, what is obvious, right? That the law of UK VK depends only on the law of UK minus one, VK minus one, and this is yes, it does not, but write down, this is M, right? Use M and just repeat the proof. Okay, maybe for the beginner, I will start next lecture by proving this, but I will see. Okay, so let us start with let us start with first try to do this, with first naive try to do this. First naive try to do this. First naive try to do this is the following. Is the following. First naive try. Naive first try. By the way, I think it works. It works for some systems, but definitely not for equations, which I keep in mind. So first naive try. First try. First try is the following. First try is the following. Choose the map for in such a way, and now watch, in such a way that for any v of k minus 1, u of k minus 1, which sits in this compact space X, right, we have relation star. Norm of S v k minus 1 eta prime k minus S of, k. Yes. Because this is nothing but v of k, right? Minus S of u of k minus 1 eta of k. This is nothing but u number k, right? So this distance, and this is distance in the space X, is bounded by 1/2 of u of k minus 1 of u of k minus 1 minus v of k minus 1, right? So distance shrink twice. Of course, it is not twice. If it simply shrink by any constant smaller than 1, it is the same, right? If we can achieve this, then we immediately have that distance between u of k, then for any omega, then for any choice of random parameter, u of k minus v of k, this distance, is bounded by 2 to degree minus k c of omega. By c of omega, this is distance between original c of omega, right? But distance between any two points like this, it is bounded by twice diameter of x. So this is bounded by 2 to minus k twice diameter of the compact x, right? If so, then you see, then this random process is uk, vk for every omega fantastically quickly converges to each other. You immediately derive from this the required property too. It's a trivial exercise. Right? The only problem that this is too good. This is too good. I cannot achieve this. But as you will see, this is idealistic, but this is not stupid. Not at all stupid. Because now I will show you what we can do. And this what we can do is something really very similar to this naive approach. So now this we can do. But what we can do? We can do the following. This is second try. Second try is the following. The following is the second try. Okay, look. First, of course, let us denote u of k minus 1, of course, you could denote it as u, and vk minus 1, of course, let us denote as v, just simply to shorten notations. We have to consider, this is 1 and notation number 3. D equals to distance between u and v, right? We have to consider two cases. This distance d is small. D is smaller than some delta, which is small constant, which you have to construct, choosing everything around, right? Or distance is big, right? Either we start with two close points or we start with two big points. Now, question, how do you think, which case is more complicated? When distance is small or when it is big, Albert? not, no, no. Right, so this is just, you see, I simply want to draw your attention to what happens, because the real difficulty is the first case, when the distance is small. But to explain why the second case is easy, I first have to explain you the first case. So look, we now consider the first case. The first case when distance d is smaller than delta. Delta will be very, very small. All this game is about very small parameter. Our control is very poor. This is d delta smaller than one. I will stress. Delta is to be chosen below. Is to be chosen. Okay. Denote by d sub index delta is vicinity of the diagonal. Is collection of pairs uv belongs to actually x times h, not here. Well, most likely you will not see why here should be complete space and not compact, but it doesn't matter. This is not really important. Such that u minus v is bounded by delta. Is bounded by delta, yes? Then look. Then maybe this is one. We start by looking at the So look, let mu and nu be measures in the sum in the sign probability space M. Definition. A coupling for this pair of measures, for this pair mu nu, is a pair of random variables, xi and eta, such that the law of xi equals to mu, such that the law of eta equals to nu, right? At first or second lecture, I told you that this is basic fact, that for every measure, we can realize every measure as the law of some random variable. But now for two measures, I choose any two random variables such that their laws are the same. What is the probability space here is of no importance. When the strategy is run, we are changing probability space systematically. So it doesn't matter. Okay. So now watch. When u and v are fixed, then just let us go here. When u and v are fixed, then eta k and eta prime k, this is some coupling for the measure L with measure L, right? Because this is a random variable with the law L, and this is a random variable with the law L, right? So for any fixed L, we are looking for any fixed pair UV, we are looking for a coupling for the pair LL. We start by looking for the coupling, which is what is the name for the coupling four in the form, which form? Eta k is just any random variable of omega, independent from everything, such that its law equals to L, right? Such that the law of eta k equals to L. Just first random variable is any random variable whose law is L. But now comes coupling, because this is precisely idea of coupling, right? So I have to relate. You see, I have two copies of the law L. I have to realize them as distributions of two random variables, which are in some complicated way related to each other. Okay, so where? Okay, and just eta prime of k, just where I am. Eta prime of k is the following. I take a random variable psi, but now watch. which, okay, random variable psi as before, which depends of u v omega, this is not the point, nothing new, so this is what is written there. New fact is below. So this random variable psi of v omega, which is info, it has the following form. First, this is eta k of omega, precisely this, plus unknown map, which depends on uv and which I apply to the eta k of omega. You see, this is tricky. So this is where KAM will now show up. You see, so I realized measure L is distribution of some random variable, right? Secondly, I realized measure L by a distribution of some random variable, which is just deformation of the region, small deformation, right? So now watch, okay. So when now and just of course, and of course my restriction is that the law of this random variable must be L, of course, right? It is written over there. Where phi is a map which is defined on the diagonal d delta times the space where the curves intersect to the space of the curve. The map should be such that, and now watch. Now I simply rewrite what is in this naive case. Look, this what I'm writing again. That S of V, and for shorthand I will denote this as zeta, right? So this is S of U eta plus zeta, right? Because this is eta plus zeta, right? It's eta plus zeta. Zeta will be small. This zeta. Sv of eta plus zeta minus S of U eta. My dream is that this is smaller than half of d star. So dream is the same, right? But now I take it seriously. First, now I want to realize this dream, assuming that this guy is close to this guy, right? And then you will see that I will do more. But now look. By Taylor formula, look, v equals to u plus small increment of size d. Eta plus zeta is equals to eta plus small increment zeta. So we can apply a Taylor formula here. So KM, you see, KM. So now watch. S of v, eta plus zeta, minus S of u eta, equals to differential of u in the first argument, calculated of u eta, apply to distance between this and this, apply to v minus u, plus second differential on eta of s, calculated also if u eta, applied to zeta, plus O capital of norm v minus u squared it, which is in fact d squared it, right? D squared it, correct? Plus norm of zeta in the space E squared it. Norm zeta in the space E squared. This is the relationship. This is the relationship, right? Now watch. If I really can do what I want to do, right? And if I actually my dream, what I keep in mind that my solution zeta will be of size d, right? Then new increment, new distance between vk plus one and uk equals to is a order of square of the square of the old distance. And this is the whole idea of the quadratic convergence, is that if I really can do this, then this sequence of pairs of random variables will converge to each other fantastically quick. Quicker than in any exponential way, right? So this is what is called the method of quadratic convergence, and this is what is inside of the KM theory. Right. Okay. Now, to achieve the goal sharp. To achieve the goal sharp. For a fixed pair UV, we have to consider the following equation on zeta. Consider the equation on zeta. Which equation? This is naturally the equation that the first term vanishes. This is called homological equation. And everybody which is doing KM theory calls this homological equation. This is double sharp, and this equation precisely at this plus this equals to zero. That this is d eta. To S applied to U eta, applied to S differential on eta of S calculated at point U eta, applied to zeta, must be equal to minus d sub index U of S calculated in the same point U eta applied to V minus U, right? Let us denote this guy F. Look, if we can solve this equation exactly, then my two pairs of random variables will start to shrink to each other fantastically quick in this super exponential way. If you find a clever way to solve this equation approximately, they still will converge to each other very quick, and this is precisely what people in the KM theory are doing. This is their bread. So what we know about the equation double sharp? What we know is the following. A, by the condition B1 prime, F belongs to space V, which is a compact, which is smoother than H, right? And B, by the condition B3 prime, this is where the strong assumptions differs from the weak assumptions, right? The map d eta has dense image. D eta of S of U eta has a dense image, right? This is a good hint that we can resolve this equation approximately. Yes, we can. This is given by the following lemma from the linear algebra. Let us denote A subindex U eta. U eta equals to differential in eta S evaluated at U eta. Now lemma from linear algebra. In view of A, for any epsilon bigger than zero, there exists an epsilon, which is just a natural number. I will later explain why I need this, and a linear operator. And a linear operator, R, upper index epsilon, lower index U eta, which maps the space H to the subspace E subindex n epsilon, which is in the space E, and which is which is simply the space generated by first an epsilon elements of some fixed basis of the space E. Somewhere in the previous lecture, I told that I apart from the basis in the space H, which is phi j, I have to fix some basis in the space L2 of 0, 1. This basis was called 1, E2, E2, E3, right? Then products of all pairs, phi j, EL makes a basis in the space of functions. And I take, so to say, Galerkin subspace in this space. So there exists a mapping such that. Now property goes such that zero. It is bounded. Norm of the mapping R epsilon in natural spaces, right, is bounded by some constant C epsilon uniformly in UV from this diagonal D delta. Image of the mapping R epsilon is finite dimensional. This is Galerkin mapping. It's a Galerkin mapping. And double E, this is approximate inverse. This is approximate inverse. So if I apply the mapping A of U eta compose with this R epsilon of U eta, if I apply to the F, then this will be almost F back. So this is bounded by epsilon norm F of V. What does it mean? It means that if I really want to solve approximately the homological equation, where is this? The homological equation, right? I simply have to choose zeta equals to R of F. R of F, and this is the solution. Okay. Why this is true? Why it is in fact very easy. It is in fact very easy because if the map R epsilon was invertible, then I could write down inverse to the map R epsilon like this. R epsilon compose with R epsilon conjugated to degree minus one, R epsilon conjugated. So this is inverse to the map R epsilon, because if I apply R epsilon to this guy, I will get identity. Now I only know that the image is dense. This operator doesn't exist. But it is positive, non-negative self-adjoint operator, right? So to get approximate inverse, I simply put here epsilon minus one, and this object exists. Right? The only disadvantage is that this operator is not Galerkin. Its image is not finite dimensional. So I may to apply some more efforts, which is not a big deal. It is easy, okay? So looks like easy. This is not a big deal. Difficulties will come later. What are difficulties here? Some difficulties. Maybe no, this is really, it is not difficult. Difficult, yes, but just to construct here proper, it's fine, yes. So this homological equation always can be solved like this. Okay. So it is like this. Now let us return with this. Now we can solve homological equation. Now homological equation is approximately solved. And now let us return Now with this operator, I can find approximate solution of the homological equation. The approximate solution is zeta equals to minus R epsilon composed to d eta s of uv applied to v minus u. This is the approximate solution. If so, then on view of the equation sharp, in view of the relationship, the following happens. Now I'm simply looking at this guy. Instead of this, will be something of order epsilon. And so what will happen will be the following. S of V, eta plus zeta, minus S of U of eta, the norm of this guy is bounded by, and now watch, is bounded by C, now times because you see, because the norm of this guy is bounded by epsilon d. C, here comes epsilon d, and here comes these two guys. These two guys, if you will see, they will be the following. C epsilon d plus epsilon. C times d. Let us analyze. No. Excuse me. Because here we should clearly see that I'm not cheating you. So this is bounded by C times D, and now comes D plus constant C, which depends on epsilon D, D and plus epsilon. Now let us understand who is who here. So this guy who is D squared, clearly this is this guy, right? This guy, but norm of zeta is bounded by C epsilon times D. Norm of zeta is bounded by C epsilon times D. So this guy, it is here, right? But also we have disparity. Disparity is here, right? Now, can we choose this in such a way that indeed the disparity of the next step is much smaller, that this is bigger than smaller than 1/2. Well, yes, we can do it. Look. First, we take epsilon so small that C epsilon is bounded by 1/6. C times epsilon is bounded by 1/6. Next, we fix this epsilon, and with this epsilon fixed, we choose delta. This is right, that d is smaller than delta, right? We choose delta because d is smaller than delta. We choose delta such that C epsilon d is bounded by 1/6. And C times D is bounded by 1/6. Yes. Yes. Yes, yeah, ask. Yes. But look here. This is precisely why we need this. We use this. S is smoothing. No, of course we should. You see, more questions. So it's yes, of course. Yes, of course. Yes, of course. Yes, 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 yes. Yes, 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 yes. Look, right. Look what happens. Right, you're just absolutely right. Look at this lemma. Lemma from linear algebra. What is bad with this lemma? This is an extremely weak statement. We have absolutely no control for this C epsilons. I have absolutely no control on this N epsilon. You see, to iterate the scheme, I can iterate the scheme only because I use probability. Only because some mean value vanishes and some some guys which would be very bad and deterministic statement simply become zero. Simply become zero. Look, because here something strange happens, because this is really quadratic convergence. This is really quadratic convergence. Really quadratic convergence, really quadratic convergence. But the rate of convergence, which I guarantee, it is only exponential. Only, I am sure that there are no super exponential convergence here. In this kind of problem, there are no super exponential convergence. No, so simply, you see? So we use very, very flexible lemma how to solve homological equation. This very flexible lemma give us very weak solution, with very poor estimate. And then it cost us quite a lot of efforts just to check that this weak estimate still allow to finish the job. On the price that the convergence is not super exponential anymore. But as some clever people told me in the original paper of Nash, he claimed in this Z paper, he claimed just exponential convergence. He did not care about this super fast things, okay? Now, where I have cheated you? Is somebody who did not read the paper but can tell me where I did cheat you? Because there is one important step to be done here. Because look, okay, so I have almost realized the first try, right? I told you that this cannot be done. Okay, first I assume that the initial data are close, okay, but because the big distance is easy, you will see. But why I did not do exactly this? You saw that. Yes. This is the whole point that this is, I have cheated you because of course the law of eta k of course is L. I took it like that, right? But eta prime k, it was constructed. So the law of eta prime k is L prime, which is not at all L. Like in Kolmogorov's theorem, the transformation which I found is very good, but it is not symplectic. It is not symplectic. If it was KM, I would be dead, but not here. I am not dead. Because, so how will I, so you see, so I have almost done what I have to do. Of course, I have to explain you what to do if the distance from U0 to U0 prime is big. Of course, it is easy, you will see. But more serious, I have to explain you how to save situation, because I cannot allow the law to be different. Here comes two more very beautiful constructions from the theory of probability. Now I will tell you one, and we will continue next time with the second one. So I will be able to almost finish the proof. Uh-huh. Okay, so look what happens. So look what happens. Okay, so I have denoted the law. Okay, the law of the random variable eta prime k is denoted L prime. But now watch how it was defined. L is a push forward. L prime is a push forward of L under the map psi, which is a push forward of map L under the map identity plus map phi, right? Map phi is such that it is easy to see. Map phi is at least C1 smooth in eta, in dependence on this, on the parameters I do not care about now. And secondly, the map F, norm of the map F, is bounded by constant times d, and thirdly, the map phi is finite dimensional. The map phi maps the space E to the space to the space E and sub-index epsilon, right? These three facts easily imply the following lemma. Lemma is the following. Let us take measure L. Let us take measure L prime. Let us measure distance with them, but not Lipschitz dual, But let us measure variational distance between them. Then variational distance between them is bounded by new constant C prime epsilon times D. This D comes there. This constant C epsilon depends on this dimension in epsilon. So growth with epsilon is very, very bad. Right? Now just let me simply recall you, what does that mean, variational distance? Oh, wonderful timing. Variational distance is defined like this. Variational distance between measures mu and mu prime, variational or total variational distance is supremum, which is taken over all Borel subsets of the space E, because it's measured on E, of mu of E minus mu prime. Mu prime of E. Another definition is that 1/2 of supremum, I take F through the all bounded function of E, and I have to calculate integral of F against mu minus integral of F against mu prime. Right? You see, this is very much like definition of Lipschitz dual distance, but the set is much bigger now. I have much more functions. I can use much more functions. And apart from this, there is extremely wide. There are two remarkable properties of variational distance. One of them is for variational distance in finite dimensional spaces. And we are effectively finite dimensional, you see. There is a good formula. So if mu 1 equals to p1 of x dx, if mu 2 equals to p2 of x dx, then the variational distance is simply integral of p1 minus p2 dx, right? So to estimate variational distance, we simply have to estimate integrals, but we are good in estimating integrals, right? Second fact about, so this is how to prove this lemma. Take this formula, the map, you see, all my restrictions on the measure L such that finite dimensional of measure L, they have Lipschitz density. The map phi here is C1 smooth. Let us write down more or less explicit formula for the density of image measure. This is simply formula for the change of variables in Lebesgue integral under diffeomorphism of the phase space. Explicit formula. And after this, we have two integrals, and this is easy job to estimate this. Of course, I repeat. So if I start to control the constants which I have here, it will be something enormous. You see, therefore, no quadratic convergence. This is only epsilon delta. For any epsilon, there exists delta such that. No, this is difference with the classical KM, right? And with this result in hand, next time I will show you how to save situation. You see, you remember that the map look. Here I look for a map F which is rather tricky. The map F is not the map. Look, the map 4, which I hear, it is of more complicated structure than what I have produced now. Because now I have eta k of omega just out of blue, right? And second copy is like this. I take psi uv applied to eta k of omega, right? You see? But here I look in this coupling in more general form. in more general form. So next time I will show you how to start in from this coupling, which is not really coupling because this measure, law of this guy is L prime and not L, how to reconstruct it, how to save situation and how to construct real coupling. There is another beautiful tool from the probability theory will show up here, which is called gluing lemma. Gluing lemma, it's what is called Dobruschen lemma, two extremely beautiful fact of the measure theory or probability theory. Okay, thank you. That's all.